Okay, play that funky music. This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this being a solo show, that means that from the studio in the bonus room above the garage, I reconfigured the studio. Things are different. Cameras look, all things are different. From the studio in the bonus room above the garage on the north side of Fort Mill, South Carolina, in the shadow of Charlotte, in the foot of Mount Belzoni, I'm Gary Pierce, K4AAQ. I am the brat, king of ham. Ask your kids. And today's program is quenching my thirst for another handheld radio. Really? All right. For some reason, and I don't think I can explain it, but for some reason, I need to change shirts. I need another handy talkie like I need another hole in the head. So, of course, I got this. It was a impulse buy, came up on Amazon Prime Day being advertised to me. It was cheap. And so I bought it, like $21 or something like that. I'm not even sure that's the cheapest you can get them for. I think you can get them for cheaper these days. And the first problem I've got is, I don't know what to call it. I don't know how to pronounce it. Let's find out. Okay, a little help here. Google, pronounce Chinese, Quanshing. What do you say?
全省. 全省.
Chesheng. But we have some other options.
全省.
Similar. Chesheng.
Quansheng.
Quansheng. Okay. Different.
Quansheng.
Okay. These two sound pretty much the same. Quansheng.
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 全省.
And.
全省.
Okay. So. Two go one way, two go another way. How about Americanizing it to easily Americanized pronunciation, just Quansheng? Let's do the unboxing. We don't do unboxings here on Ham Radio Now very much, and we don't do product reviews very much. Again, this was an impulse buy, and David seemed to recommend it. A few other people that I know recommended it. Let's check it out. Yes, I have opened the cover of this box once, but I haven't pulled things out. So, let's just look at the box first. Wait a minute. It's a portable multiband transceiver, multiband transmitting and receiving, AM, FM aviation band receiving. Okay, cool. Just the name. High battery capacity, wireless radio replication, scrambler, okay. Anything else? NOAA weather alert, multiband transmitting receiving, AM FM aviation band receiving, crossband intercom, easy copy one channel act as frequency meter, okay, whatever. Wireless radio replication, emergency alert, FM radio, scrambler, DTMF, multi-scan, CTCSS, DCS, high-capacity battery, long standby time, long communications range. And so, you know, the interesting thing that it doesn't say anywhere on the box? Amateur radio. Doesn't say what service it's for. But it doesn't say amateur radio, that's for sure. Okay, let's open the box. Got our two-way radio user manual. Don't ever need that. Okay, there's the radio itself. Comes right up at the top. Battery is behind it. It's pretty small. Big orange knob on the top. It's got a light. It's got the ubiquitous Chinese radio flashlight. I think, the wrong direction, in my estimation, antenna gender. Bunch of buttons. Looks like a pretty big speaker. An FCC ID. Model UV5K. Output power, 5 watts.
frequency range 144 to 148, 420 to 450. And there is an FCC ID number. Okay, take out the battery. Sometimes they come with a little bit of charge and sometimes they don't. Should have tested this before. Can't even figure out how to put on the battery. Now it's stuck on the bottom, but it won't close on the top. I got a feeling I'll be editing this out. There's the battery releases on the bottom. It took me a minute to figure out how to put the battery on. You slide it on the top and then clamp it on the bottom, and the battery release is this button on the bottom. Okay, and I'll put the antenna on just in case somehow I accidentally transmit. Don't want to do it with no antenna. If the battery's got enough charge and all that stuff. And now, where's the power button? Is it that? Apparently not. There's an exit. I don't see a power button. I don't see anything marked with the universal power symbol. Oh. It's on the volume control. Click. Welcome. Channel mode 1. It's in channel mode 1. All right, so we've unboxed the radio. I'm not going to try to figure out how to actually use it yet, because there's a few more things inside the box here. Looks like there's a little headset that will probably be kind of junk. And a drop-in battery charger with USB. USB connection to the drop-in battery charger. Do they give me a wall wart? Yes. Yep. Little bitty wall wart. It's USB standard A, not USB-C. But it could probably, you know, plug into any USB connection, any USB-A connection. All right. And so, yeah, the radio had some charge to it. Let's see. It looks like it's pretty well charged up. Not quite full, maybe. And it comes with a belt clip that goes on the battery, but it doesn't make you go get a screwdriver to put it on. Just slides in. And it took me a minute to figure out how to get it off. There's a little tab underneath here that you can lift up and it will slide right back off. So if you buy a second battery, I don't know if it's going to come with a belt clip or not. But if it doesn't, it's easy to move from one battery to another without tools. Pretty tiny. The unboxing is complete. Now I go learn how to use it. So as I got ready to demonstrate the radio, I had a little problem. With the backlight off, the display is hard to see. You can sort of see it if I get the reflection just right. And with the backlight on, it's totally blown out. And there are no illumination adjustments. It's just on or off. It is also only, you can only set it to be always off, in which case you can almost never see it. Or on for 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 seconds, and there's no setting for always on. We're going to be fighting that throughout the demo. In any case, I needed a way to let you see the display easily, and so I brought the lens from a broken pair of sunglasses, and voila, it's going to work. There's the radio with the sunglasses over the display. I can tell you right off the bat that the big thing about this radio, what everybody is all excited about, is that there's several aftermarket firmware downloads that you can put into the radio that make it do all kinds of different things. I haven't gone there yet, haven't experimented with any of them. We're just going to look at what the radio is able to do pretty much stock out of the box. There's a pretty decent user manual for it. The tiny one that comes in the box on paper that someone with eyes my age can't read. But you can get a PDF version, and it's decent. Not super in-depth, but it's decent. Let's take a look at the buttons and other stuff on the outside of the radio. If the have we turned it on? Yeah. Once again, it turns on with the click of the volume knob, like ancient TVs used to do. The menu button. And it brings up a pretty extensive menu. We're going to review just about pretty much everything in the menu. We can dump out of it with the exit button. And then each button has a shortcut to a menu item function. And the function button is this button down here in the lower right. So you press that first and then press the other button. And you're back into the menu. In this case, it was band. Which, when you're in the memory system, doesn't do much. So let's go to VFO. We'll skip over number two, which is the AB button. Get that in a second. And now we'll switch bands. Lots of bands. Okay, back to memory. So there is an A and a B side. The A side is the top. The B side is the bottom. And I prefer the option of a single button to switch back and forth. But this makes you push the function button and button number two, and it will switch back and forth. And we saw what function number three does. Function 4 starts the radio scanning. Function 5 takes you to the NOAA weather channels. Okay, so it was strange. I got myself hung up in the NOAA weather band trying to figure out how to get out, and switching back to memory or VFO didn't do anything. But function and the 5 key for NOAA weather took me back to the VFO, and then switching from VFO back to memory got me back into the memories. Okay, the next options are the high, medium, and low power. There's a Vox option. I never actually use Vox. There's a reverse button. Let's see, we're not on a repeater channel, but let's go to one. And if we were receiving a signal from the repeater and we're close enough to hear somebody on simplex, switching to reverse, see the R point pops up in the display, would switch us to the input. Well, it did, we just don't have anybody to listen to there. And finally, the 9 is a quick move to a memory channel that you can set as the call channel. All right, let's take a look around the rest of the radio. On the side, fairly standard Kenwood type microphone, speaker mic connections, and a USB-C port for what they call emergency charging. On the other side, push to talk switch, and then 2 programmable buttons. You can't program everything into them, but there's maybe about a dozen parameters you can program in. We'll take a look at that in a little bit. And on the back, just the the belt clip. And yes, I remember the button to release the battery. Up on top, I don't know why the big honking orange volume control, but it is. And then the flashlight function, which was assigned to a side button and included turning on the alarm if you push the button too many times. So I've disabled that. I guess I won't be using the flashlight. Let's go review the stuff in the menu. The manual has a pretty good rundown of what's in the menus. Some things are left for you to sort of figure out. The squelch is set in the menu. And as I said, squelch position number one, for me anyway, is still a little bit too tight. And by the way, if you're starting outside the menu, you push the menu button once to select which menu item you want, and you push it again to get into making the settings. You see the little carrot appears. And it will say, if you leave the voice on, it will say what you're working on, and when you're done, confirm, and then the exit button takes you back out. So again, the squelch is a little bit too tight for me, because I like to have the squelch open and stay open on the weakest signals. It only closes when the signal's totally gone. That's not what happens with this radio and a lot of the Chinese radios. I can give you a little demo of that. Listening to a NOAA weather channel, because it's a good, consistent, always-on-the-air channel, I'll use my hand to detune the antenna some and make the signal drop out. And then I programmed one of the side buttons to just open the squelch and be wide open. So you'll see as I make the signal weak, now I'll open it with the side button, and it's noisy, but it's still fully audible. But the squelch closes on it. So that's the squelch performance I'd like to have. I'd like to see it stay open even with that very weak signal. Moving on. Channel step or frequency step goes down to 2.5 kilohertz, and then 5 kilohertz, 6 and a quarter, 10, 12 and a half, and 25. Missing is 15 kilohertz, something that you'll find in most of the other Japanese radios anyway. 15 kilohertz is the channel step for some 2-meter repeaters in some of the country. Gets a little bit confusing. On 2 meters, you'll have two channel steps. You'll have 15 kilohertz and you'll have 20 kilohertz. And it depends on what part of the band and also what part of the country you're in. So, okay, this doesn't do 15 kilohertz. So 5 kilohertz is the least common denominator for 2-meter channels. So if you're going to be stepping through them on the VFO, 5 kilohertz is where you got to be. Transmit power. It says low, mid, and high, but it doesn't say here, and it doesn't say in the specifications what those are, except that high power is, well, it says less than 5 watts. Let's go take a look at the watt meter and see what the power really is. This is on VHF high power, supposed to be 5 watts, and we see about 3.5 watts. Switch to low power. Not very low, just over 2 watts. And medium power, about 2.5 watts. So low power is not as low as maybe it ought to be. And high power is not as high as maybe it ought to be. Let's try UHF. So UHF high power, slightly higher than VHF, but still just about 3.5 watts. UHF low power, again, about 2 watts. UHF medium power, 2.5 watts. The next four menu items are for both receive and transmit either subaudible tone or digital tone. And the radio lets you set your tone independently, so you can have receive CTCSS on one frequency and the transmit on another CTCSS frequency. Or you can even have the receiver on a digital tone, digital DCS, and the transmitter on analog tone, or vice versa. A lot of the Japanese radios have locked you into a single tone, transmit and receive. And some repeaters are being set up now with a different tone on the input than on the output. I think some of the newer Japanese radios are beginning to have the flexibility to let you do that. But my old guard radios have you locked in. This radio gives you the full flexibility. I guess I should note that there's no on and off switch for the tones. The off switch is part of the tone selector. Get all the way down below the lowest tone, and that's where you find the off switch. And I keep messing up because in order to lock something in, any change that you've made here, you can't just set it, dial to that point and then exit. You have to push the menu button to get that confirm, and then it is off. There's a part of the manual that is confusing and more complicated than it has to. The menu is kind of goofy in the offset language it uses. It calls it frequency deviation setting. We use the word deviation for something else in FM. It's really just a good old plus and minus offset direction, but they get really complicated in describing it. And like I say, deviation, well, it's not wrong. I suppose we're setting up how far the transmit frequency is going to deviate from the receive frequency. Not wrong, but we use the term deviation in a different way, and it is more confusing than it needs to be. It's just the plus or minus offset. And in fact, that's the way it shows up on the display. Just plus, minus, and off for simplex. It's just that easy. The next menu item is called offset. And they go into a little word salad on that. Frequency of frequency deviation. What the heck does that mean? Again, that's just the plain old offset that we use, which on 2 meters is mostly 600 kilohertz. It can be plus or minus. And on 220, this radio doesn't do 220, but on 220, it's 1.6 megahertz. It does receive 220, but it doesn't transmit there. A 220 is 1.6 megahertz, and it's always minus. 220 is the band where we learned from all the mistakes that we made on 2 meters and 440, and we fixed them. On 440, the offset is almost always 5 megahertz, could be plus or minus, and that's depending on what part of the country you're in. Different regions of the country have a high-in, low-out, or low-in, high-out, but the input and output are always 5 megahertz apart. Next is what they're going to call channel bandwidth. This is what we normally call deviation, but they couldn't use that term because they'd already used it up someplace else. It's where you set the radio to wide or narrow. And I had a huge fight online about this. There was a guy who was insisting that all amateur operation on FM was narrow. And that's because the specs for this radio say that the max frequency deviation is equal to or less than 5 kilohertz, and then in parentheses, 25 kilohertz. What does that mean? And then for narrow, it would be equal to or less than 2.5 kilohertz, and in parentheses, 12.5 kilohertz. And he was reading that as the 25 kilohertz was going to be the maximum deviation that you could have from the radio. And that's wrong. The maximum deviation you can have is 5 kilohertz or 2.5 kilohertz in the narrow setting. What he was mixing up was the deviation, 5 kilohertz, and the channel step of 25 kilohertz that's typically associated with a 5 kilohertz deviation radio. Doesn't have to be 25 kilohertz. In fact, in ham radio, we typically use 20 kilohertz for some of the 2 meter band, all of 220, and in some areas of the country, California is going to 20 kilohertz channel steps, but all still 5 kilohertz deviation. So yes, it's a little bit confusing, and he wanted to stay confused. The next menu item is encrypted communications, or well, it's not digitally encrypted on this radio. You can do it. It is just scrambled. I think it's a function of voice frequency inversion or conversion to different frequencies and turning them upside down, something like that. Not legal on ham radio. So I'm going to take the antenna off and use the dummy load so I'm not officially transmitting out into the air and show you what it looks like. There's 10 different steps. They sound a little bit different, but they all do about the same thing. So let me show you what this sounds like.
Testing. Testing again, please. No fair crowd. Crowd fair fuel cooling down. Testing again, please.
Said a different scrambling code, but I think it's not going to sound that much different.
Testing. Again, please. No fair crowd. Crowd fair fuel cooling down. Again, please. No fair crowd.
So it's an analog method of just kind of mixing up the frequencies. And yes, dummy load, because not legal on ham radio. There is a busy channel lockout function. You don't really want to use that because if you're talking through a repeater that has a fairly long hang time, in other words, the repeater transmitter stays on the air for several seconds after someone stops talking, that's still being interpreted as a busy channel by the radio, so you can't transmit to the repeater until it drops off the air. And some repeaters, that's fine. They have a short hang time, but some are a fairly long hang time, and you can't wait for that to go on, or you'll never get a word in a group conversation. The next step is saving to a memory channel, and this is something you'll do a lot. Now, I would recommend that you use software. It works with Chirp. There's an RT Systems program for it because you got up to 200 channels, and that's a lot of button pushing on the front panel. But you can do it, and you should know how to do it in the field when you're away from your computer. So you can put in a channel that is missing if you're in some event or just you find a repeater that you want to talk through in a town you have traveled to. So let's take a look at that. It's more than just setting the frequency. You also want to set your receive and transmit subaudible tones and your offset, because all those things get stored in the memory channel. And you start with VFO. I have switched to VFO, and I'm going to put in 147.000. And when it gets that last digit, it knows you put in all the numbers you can. And so that's what's sitting there. And I got my offset and tones and all that stuff all set for the way I want them. So we'll go into the menu for memory channel. And as I step up and down, it's stepping through the available memory channel numbers. But it's not telling me whether the channel I'm going to write to is busy or not, whether it's already got something in it or not. Most of the other radios that I've got at least put a caret or an icon or fill some little hole in the screen to indicate that there's already something in the channel. But not this one. It's not going to tell me. Most of these are filled up to about 125, I think. So let me go up plenty high. Let's go up to about 135. Pretty sure there's nothing in there. And we'll write to it by pushing the memory button again. Asks if I'm sure. I'm sure. Yeah, I'm sure. Confirm. And we're still in VFO mode, so let's go to
channel mode.
And there it is in channel 135. I can't enter the alphanumerics on the radio. I would like to be able to put in something about that, but I can't unless I use the computer. And so if I switch to frequency, it's going to switch globally for everything in the radio. like most handhelds with a battery where you want to maximize your battery time, there's a battery save feature, which basically turns off as many things as they can, turns off the power to the receiver for a specified period of time. And you can set it based on, looks like four different intervals. A ratio of like 1 to 4 would be one part listening, four parts off. The longest battery saving and the most power setting at 1 to 4. It's hard to evaluate it because you never know where in a 1 to 4 cycle you are. So when I key up, it may respond instantly, or it may have just been turned on and just got turned off, and it's going to wait its full period before it turns on. And I don't know when that is. But anyway, let's see what happens. Let me talk. Can I make this real obvious with my thumb here? Yeah, you could see a little bit of delay, just a little. I also don't know quite how long it takes to reset, because it's going to stay in full power mode for a while. Try one more time here. Watch the thumb. Yeah, quarter of a second or so. I've seen it a little bit longer. I've seen it shorter. Vox, voice activated transmitter. I never use it on FM. I don't use it on sideband that much either. But we're going to skip it because I don't think it's very good on FM. ABR. We've been seeing this. The result of this in the demo quite often so far, it's just the backlight. I don't know what the initials ABR are supposed to mean, but it's basically the automatic backlight. And the options are off, so you never have backlight. And then either on for 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 seconds after either you push a button or it begins to receive a signal. And I wish it could be a little bit longer, but you get 5 seconds. TDR, dual watch. I have no idea, once again, what TDR means, but the radio is dual display and dual watch, but not true dual receive. It still only receives on one of the channels at a time. If the A side is busy receiving a signal, the B side is ignored until a few seconds after the A side stops receiving. And now the manual is confusing here, and the operation is a little bit odd. The options are off, and with TDR off, only the selected side is going to receive. The non-selected side still shows up in the display, but it ignores any signals. You don't hear them, you don't see them. If you select the channel A option, this does put the radio into dual watch, as I mentioned before. The first side, A or B, to receive, I say side with some kind of air quotes in my voice, because it's not left and right, it's up and down on the display. Okay, never mind. The first side, A or B, that captures the receiver, the other side is ignored until, once again, the first side is quiet for a couple seconds. Then it goes back to, I'll pick either one, whichever comes in first. It's a relay race. And there's something else. One side is selected and the other one isn't. So if the radio is selected for side A, but a transmission comes in on side B, you can transmit back on side B without having to tell the radio to switch sides. And then that option disappears after a few seconds. So let's see that in action, if I've got enough hands to make that happen. The radio is set for side A as the main channel. And I'm going to give a little transmission on the frequency set for the B side, 446.0. And you see a little caret shows up on 446. If I transmit on 5.2, the A side, the caret's on the A side. Quickly back to B before the screen times out. Okay, paying no attention for a few moments, and now it can receive on side B. But where do I transmit? Well, watch this. My transmitting is happening on side B, even though the carrot's on side A. And in a moment, it's going to drop out. And I'm transmitting on side A, and I didn't switch back and forth. Did it all by itself. The next menu item is called WX, so that is clearly something about the weather, the NOAA channels, right? No, it is not. I don't know. The way they name things here, what that does is it turns the function I just described a moment ago on or off. That is, with WX set to off, then you get that thing where you transmit on the side that was last received, whether you've selected that as the main channel or not. But if you select A or B, the radio only transmits on the selected main channel. It won't switch to the other side, even if the other side has received a signal. The A and the B don't seem to make any difference, unless I missed something. There is this beep function. No, that's not the Roger beep. That's going to come later. It's just whether or not the radio is going to beep at you each time you push a button. There is a timeout timer. It's for the transmitter, selectable from 1 to 10 minutes or off. I usually select 2 minutes. I'm not usually that long-winded on the air, unlike on, for example, this podcast. Now and then I do get kind of wound up and I time myself out. Many repeaters have 3-minute timers, so it's good to have a shorter setting. Plus, this is a handy talkie. You don't want to be making those super long transmissions. You don't have the battery for it. Here's where you turn on and off the voice prompt and also possibly practice your Chinese. The radio has a decently fast scanner in it. And I have no idea what SCREV means. I mean, scan, yes, but REV, I don't know. It's got the same usual 3 methods for either continuing the scan or not. TO, can I guess what that means? Maybe like timeout. The scan resumes after 5 seconds. So you're listening to a signal, and 5 seconds goes by, and it moves on whether the signal is done or not. CO, carrier out? I don't know. In any case, it waits until the carrier is dropped, and then it will start to scan. And then SE, no idea. But if it receives a signal, it stops scanning and won't start again at all. Menu. So we set the scanning to TO, what I'll call timeout, for a 5-second wait before it moves on, and start it scanning, which I programmed it to do on one of these side buttons. And away it goes, and I'll quickly transmit here on 5.2. So it stops. There it is, making some feedback, and because the light's going to go out, but the feedback, lack of feedback indicates it has started scanning again. And it should come around to the 5.2. It's going to take a while. It's a fairly fast scanner for a Chinese radio, but it's not super fast. So it'll come around to 5.2. I'm still holding transmit on 5.2 here on this radio, K4AAQ testing. If anybody's listening out there, they're wondering what the hell's going on. And there we go. We're on 5.2. Feedback, 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 and off it moves. And it's not on 5.2 anymore. K4AAQ. MDF, another cryptic shortcut. Meaning what? Well, I don't know, but it sets what the display is going to show, either frequency, the channel number, or an alphanumeric name, which can be up to 10 characters, but can only be set using the PC software. You can't enter a name using the radio itself. And so that means if you program a frequency in the field, you'll only know it by either the frequency or the channel number, but not by a name because you can't put in the name. And these are my alphanumeric names for many of the repeaters found in the Charlotte metropolitan area. It's shortcut stuff with only 10 characters to work with. all meaningful to me. Sad, one and sad two. I'm not sad about this. I'm happy because there are two scan lists in the radio. Yeah, we saw it scan a minute ago. You can assign any memory channel to either of the scan lists, you know, all of them or just a few of them, or you can leave memory channels out, and that would be called skip in most radios. Another menu option, a little bit later, selects which list is going to be used when scanning. Two separate lists, and you pick one or the other. So for this memory channel, channel 001, 52 simplex, I can set it to be on for list one or off. And I can set it to be on or off for list two. So now I've got it set so that whichever list I scan, list one or list two, it's going to include channel 001 or 14652. And I'm going to skip down a few items in the menu list because I don't know why this wasn't right under the SAD1 and SAD2, but this is S list, and it just tells the radio which scan list to scan, either list one or list two. And now I'm going to go back and pick up those menu items that I skipped over. STE, tail tone elimination. All right, this is a little hard to describe. The manual is not specific about it, but it appears to be a receive function. And briefly, turn it off, I get a squelch tail from repeaters that are sending tone. Turn it on, and I don't get a squelch tail from repeaters that are sending tone. All right, here's how squelch tail elimination works. And they call it tail tone, but it's really squelch tail elimination. Here's how it works. I mean, you got a transmission going, receiver's receiving it. Transmission stops, and usually there's a little burst of noise before the receiver squelch closes and takes away all the noise. In an FM receiver, if you don't have squelch, you would be hearing this all the time. So squelch is what makes it go away. And you don't want that squelch to close at the end of a signal real fast, because if a signal is noisy and fluttering, you don't want that squelch opening and closing and opening and closing. And some Chinese radios are real bad about that. My Anytones aren't very good at not closing the squelch too soon. So you get the squelch tail. But people don't like squelch tails. Some people really don't like squelch. I kind of like them. You know, back during the old Broadrick Crawford days, 2150 dead quarters, psh, I like that. The big, big bursty squelch tail. Engineers have done some tricks to make squelch tails go away. One of them is this squelch tail elimination thing. Now, back in the early days of subaudible tone, you needed a mechanical vibrating reed to generate the tone and another reed that was caused to vibrate in your receiver to detect the tone and to turn on the speaker. And so what the engineers discovered is if there was a way to stop that receiver vibrating tone from vibrating before you dropped your carrier, you wouldn't get a squelch tail. The audio, the speaker would close before the transmitter dropped, not leaving any time for that squelch tail to happen. Well, that was pretty cool. It worked pretty well. We don't use vibrating reeds anymore. Everything is totally electronic. And so you can set radios up so that they're sending a tone, and all this pretty much requires tone, subaudible tone or DCS operation. You can set the radio up so that when you stop transmitting, the tone goes off and it takes another 100 milliseconds or so, 10th of a second, before the transmitter goes off. And in that time, the receiving station's squelch can close and there's no squelch tail. So that's pretty cool. So most of these radios will do that. You make a transmission, you've got tone turned on, and you let go. The tone goes off, transmitter stays on for a short period of time. I've never seen a setting in a radio that can turn that off and say, let's not do that. But this radio has that setting, so let's do a little example. I don't have a repeater to play with, but I can simulate it using my Bofeng radio, which has the option to send or not send that little extra burst of signal at the end with no tone on it to make this receiver close. So first, let's set the squelch tail elimination. Okay, it is already set to off. And so here's what happens when we get a signal. K4AAQ testing. Turn the volume up plenty. K4AAQ testing. Now let go and you hear that little burst. The Bofeng radio, by the way, is leaving that brief period on after I stop transmitting. But for some reason, the control of this Quansheng radio can be set to ignore that. I'm not sure how it ignores it, but it does. So anyway, we'll go back to the menu and we'll turn squelch tail elimination on. Now, I have played with this on a bunch of repeaters and determined, yeah, it does work on repeaters as well. So now I'm going to transmit with the Bofeng radio. Well, the little feedback wasn't what I was looking for. But the signal goes away and no squelch tail. Testing 1, 2. And once again, I'll turn the squelch tail elimination off. So you have the power. You can turn it on and off in the radio. And I'll guess I'll leave it on. Now there's one more setting that looks similar, but it's RPSTE, repeater tail tone elimination off and on. And I will confess, I don't know what that means. I don't know what the difference is. I've turned that setting on and off and I can't make anything different happen. I'm sure it does something. I can't figure it out. Yes, I've been beat. Turning my crown as King of Ham. Here's something I understand better. Mic sensitivity. Yes, there's a microphone gain setting. A lot of radios didn't have that for a long time. I'm seeing it in more and more radios now. It is useful, but there is no way to know what setting is best for you other than those notoriously unreliable signal reports, aka radio checks. But if a lot of people are telling you your audio is too loud, turn it down. And if a lot of people are telling you you're too soft, turn it up. If you've got it all the way up and they're still telling you you're too soft, look, stop talking into your radio like this. You're not supposed to talk into the radio like this. You're supposed to talk into the radio like this. It's not going to bite. Ow, it bit me. Next is one call. Okay, kind of obtuse. When I tell you what it is, it'll make sense, I guess. The one key call channel. Select the channel through the up-down keys and the number keys. Okay, not making as much sense as I wanted to. Let's look at the radio. Okay, there's the one call. And what we're basically seeing is our channel list there on the right as I scroll through it. We can select a channel. Let's just select channel 001, which I happen to know is the simplex channel 14652. Now, how do I use it? Well, the manual is not going to tell you. I figured it out, and it wasn't that hard. I'll push function, and 9 here says call. And sure enough, it took me back to channel 1. So once again, let me just step through a bunch and get away a little bit. And now, function, call. And it bopped me right back to channel 001. A lot of radios have what they say is a call channel set up specifically. So this radio doesn't specifically have a channel memory called call. You can just assign any of the 200 memories to be the call channel and get to it without having to push too many buttons. So that works pretty well. Almod. short for alarm mode. Don't use this. Okay, yay. The radio's got alarm modes. Okay, so the options are sight, and that means that it's only going to play the alarm in the radio speaker. So if you need to sound the alarm, but only very locally, turn up your volume and make your radio go weep, 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 sounding the alarm. The tone mode turns on the transmitter and makes it go out over the air. I don't know why they call it the tone mode. Maybe because the radio sends a tone. Where do they get the names? I don't know. Anyway, the radio comes with alarm mode defaulted to one of the buttons on the side here. It's along with the light mode. You push it a couple times and light comes and goes, and you hold it and the alarm goes off and sends the alarm out over the radio. Turn it off. You don't need it. Turn it off. Next are a bunch of touch tone functions that I'm never going to use, and I'm guessing that you won't either. Basically, they let you mute your radio until your set of touch tone digits are received. In other words, say your radio is 1, 2, 3. Somebody out there in radio land transmits with 1, 2, 3, and your radio opens up. Otherwise, it's going to stay closed. Sort of a touch tone squelch. And I remember that ICOM put that feature in some of its radios back in the day, and I guess nobody used them, so they removed them. I think a few other manufacturers tried that too. I'm going to skip them all except for the DST, and that lets you turn your touch tone side tone on and off. And so when it's on, you hear the touch tones that you're sending through your speaker. And either when you're sending them manually by pushing buttons or using one of those automated functions, which I'm telling you not to use. And then when you turn it off, you're not hearing the touch tones, even though they're being transmitted. So you probably want it turned on. PON message, I guess. Yeah, power on message. Three things that can display when you turn the power on. One is called a full screen display, which just means it turns on all the little dots on the dot matrix. The next one is the welcome message, which you can program if you've got a computer. And the third is voltage. And I programmed in my call sign, and it came out kind of glitched, so I just leave mine on voltage. And now what everyone wants on their radio, a Roger beep. A reminder of end to talk. I guess you need to be reminded that you stopped talking. Turned off, there's no reminding. In Roger, you get reminding. And what is this, MDC? A frog sound tail tone? I got to hear that. I probably need to turn on one of the other radios so I'll hear it. We all on the same channel? And we're still on 5.2 there. Turn the volume up well. Still on 5.2 here. I hate these displays that disappear. Okay, let's see what we hear. Can I have a Roger beep? There it is.
K4AAQ, Roger beep testing.
Turn your Roger beeps off, please. But I got to see what the frog thing is. Okay. Set it for frog. That kind of emulates a set of chirping that Motorola radios do, but on those they're sending out some kind of ID. This is sending out, I have no idea what. Maybe it is programmed for something somewhere else in the menu. We haven't quite got there yet.
K4AEQ.
Turn them off. Vol. Now, of course, if you ask me, VOL, vol, is an abbreviation for the word volume. But not here. Here it is voltage, battery voltage, which is useful, but do they have to call it vol? All right, let's see. Oh, you don't even have to do anything. It just, you get there and it displays what the current battery voltage is. All right, fine. NOAA channel auto scan. Those are the whether broadcast at around 162 or so megahertz. Auto scan, I don't know, but there are some buttons on the front of the radio that say NOAA. So let's turn auto scan on and then punch the NOAA button and see what happens. Down here is the NOAA button. It's a function key button operation. So function NOAA. And it's sitting there, but it's not scanning. I tuned in the NOAA frequencies manually, not using their scanner thing. I can hear them on a couple channels. But when it was allegedly scanning, I didn't hear anything. So I don't know. Don't know what it's scanning. Don't know how it works. What gets programmed needs to be deleted sometimes. So here's the function for deleting a memory channel. It's pretty simple. You just go to this menu item, select the channel you want. You can only see the channel number. You can't see the alphanumerics or the frequency that you put into it. So you've got to figure out which channel it is, but then you can easily delete it. What I haven't found is a function that will let you edit the parameters that you've got in a channel to change the tone, change the offset, things like that. It may be in there somewhere, but I haven't found it. All I can do is rebuild a channel from the VFO and then store it back over the original channel. But if I'm doing that on the radio, once again, I lose the alphanumerics and I can't put them back in until I'm back on the computer. Maybe there's a way to do that. I haven't found it. I found one more interesting thing. Well, actually, a bunch of interesting things, all based on this menu, and this is pressing the function key, which is the lower right-hand key on the keyboard, plus one of the other numeric keys, and there are a bunch of quick functions you can get to. We saw change bands, I think, a little while ago, switching between the A and B channels, between VFO and memory, frequency meter, that just made no sense, the NOAA we saw, high, medium, and low power we saw, turning on and off Vox, well, since I'm not going to use Vox, I don't care about that. You can switch to reverse on repeaters. So if you're listening to a repeater and you want to see if you can hear the guy that you're talking to direct without the repeater, function plus R. And it shows a little R in the menu. It's not showing frequency, so you really don't see the frequency change. That just that little R to tell you that you have reversed and you were listening on the input. The F plus the star key starts a CTCSS or DCS search. But let's see what happens. I'm going to transmit to it, and I've got a tone set up in the good old Bofung. Let's see what tone I've got set up. Oh, nothing. All right, let's set one. Let's set a good high one. Let's set that 254. That'll work. And now we will press the star key.
Scanning begin.
Function plus star. It didn't take long. It was real quick to identify that
Ansel.
254 tone. Let's do that again. Yeah, it's one of the fastest tone finders that I have come across. And I like the idea of a tone finder. I kind of wish, you want to hear my holy grail on this? Sure you do. I wish every radio would have the ability to listen to a tone on the receiver that's coming out of a repeater and automatically set the transmitter to that tone. Now, it's a function you don't want to happen all the time, because sometimes repeaters transmit a different tone than they're receiving. So you want to be able to turn it off or do some modification to it. But for the most part, if you tune into a repeater, especially if you're out driving, if you're traveling, and you come upon a repeater that's on the air, folks are talking, and you want to join in, but it's tone, and you don't know what it is. And the tone scan on most radios is abysmal. It's hard to get to. It takes a long time. In a lot of radios, it shuts the receiver off, shuts the speaker off while it's searching, and doesn't open the speaker until it finds the tone. So I wish radios would just automatically get that tone, program it into the transmitter, and turn it on. But nobody does that. But this is, well, not really coming close, but at least it finds a tone fast. That's something. And then last is FM. Yeah, there's FM broadcast receiver here in the radio. I've got it set for one of my programmable side buttons here. Oh, I found the alarm. I did that reset. Hope we're not on the air. Oh, great. We're on the air. Yay. I did that reset. It changed all the functions. I haven't gone back and replaced them all. I'm going to go reprogram the radio. I'll be right back. Don't go away. There is an FM broadcast receiver in here. Function plus zero FM. And I've got a few memories stored. Or you can switch to VFO. Now, in the regular ham radio stuff, switching to VFO is function plus the 3, but not the FM receiver. There, it's function plus 1, and you're in the VFO. It goes down to where the European FM broadcast band is. But you can you'll get her back up into the U.S. commercial band. If you're over in Europe, you're all set. Okay, back and forth between memories. One last thing. Really? One last thing? Sure. The radio can copy itself to another radio, another K5 radio, over the air. I don't have another K5 radio, but I can at least see what it sounds like. In order to initiate that, you have to hold down side button number 2 and push to talk while turning it on, rubbing your tummy and patting your head at the same time. And now, warning, it comes up defaulted to do that on 410.025 megahertz. That is not in the ham band. You can put in 4, 4, 6, 0, 0, 0 a ham band channel, which it will be happy to accept. And now you start the copying by pushing the menu button, and I'll just receive it over here on the Bofeng. So I was expecting it to send touch tones, but instead it's sending this little burst of data, one frequency or one memory channel at a time. And there doesn't appear to be any way to make it stop except to, the exit key is not doing it. Does any key stop it? Nothing I can find out. Just turning it off, of course, will make it stop. Make it stop! There may be a few things I didn't get into. I'm sure there are a few things I didn't get into. Besides all the stuff that you can do by putting in the custom firmware, which I may get into someday and make a future program. So that will be it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Wait a minute. I'm Gary Pierce, K4AAQ. I am the king of ham. I'm still high res. I'm also, potentially, Brad. We'll find out about that someday. Over and out.